वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू, क्लियरली ऑडिबल एंड विजिबल। अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। सो लेट अस स्टार्ट विद आवर सेशन ऑफ मस्ट नो एमसीक्यूज फॉर योर अपकमिंग एग्जाम्स ऑन 16th ऑफ जून, दैट इज योर INICET एग्जाम्स। सो बिफोर स्टार्टिंग द सेशन, a quick briefing about Unacademy NEET PG Plus subscription, where you get unlimited access for all the courses for the entire duration of your subscription with daily live classes. Then this limited time offer where the prices of each duration of subscription has been slashed is still there. Then with every 3-month subscription, now you get 1 month in extra without any extra charges. And with every 12-month subscription, you get 2 months in extra. Then these are your batch courses which have started on 9th of June, targeting your NEET PG exams and next 2022 exams. This is a professional year 2 batch course which has again started on 9th of June, targeting your 4 subjects of second year, that is pathology, pharma, micro and FM. And this is the referral code which a subscriber can utilize at the time of checkout to get a 10% discount. So we are good to go. Let us start with our MCQ round. All of you can put your answers in the live chat window. A very good morning. A very good morning to all. So we are good to go. First question. What should be the answer to this one? Fishy odor is associated with which poisoning? All of you can put your answers in the live chat window. Fishy odor is associated with which poisoning? So this is one topic which is sure shot topic. It has a sure shot answer. There is no confusion in this. That yes, fishy odor is associated with your phosphites. Which phosphites? Zinc phosphate as well as aluminium phosphate. Zinc and aluminium phosphate, they have a fishy odor. Then what is the odor of hydrogen sulfide, anyone? This is the odor of your hydrogen sulfide poison. It has got a rotten egg-like odor, rotten egg. Then what is the odor of chloral hydrate? Acrid pear-like. So this table of odors is very important for your upcoming INICET exams. So let us have a quick briefing about this table. Starting with A alphabet, you have acrid pear-like odor due to chloral hydrate and paraldehyde poisons. Then your apple-like odor is due to chloroform and ethanol. This is with alphabet A, acrid, pear-like and apple-like. Then with alphabet B, we have bitter almond and burnt rope. Bitter almond is due to cyanide. This is also a repeat question multiple times. It has been asked. Then burnt rope odor is due to cannabis. Then carrot-like odor, come to alphabet C, carrot-like odor is due to poison hemlock, mainly due to this toxin called sisu toxin in poison hemlock plants. Then garlicky-like odor is due to many poisons like arsenic, OPC group of compounds, phosphorus, P4 phosphorus and aluminium phosphate. Now this aluminium phosphate has got two types of odors, garlicky as well as fishy. This should be remembered. But if you have to pick one best, go with fishy odor. Because garlicky is associated with many other poisons too. Then glue-like odor is associated with your toluene. Toluene is the most common substance used for solvent abuse. This is the most common substance used for inhalant abuse, volatile substance abuse or solvent abuse. Then OPCs also have another odor called kerosene-like odor. Those pesticides which have this solvent called aromats, they smell like kerosene. Then rotten egg, H2S poisoning. Fishy is due to all phosphites, aluminium phosphate and zinc phosphate. Then this is a repeat AIIMS question itself. Two polish odor is associated with nitrobenzene poisoning. Don't forget this table. So we have revised it. Let us move on to next question. Pick the best answer. And put in your answers in the live chat window. Which one is correct about moon rocks combination? What you will mark as your answer? What is moon rocks? So waiting for your responses in the live chat window. So correct answer is, what should be the correct answer to this one? Yes, go on answering. This can be an area which can be explored in upcoming exams. Any exam, INI as well as FMG exams. Moon rocks is a combination of smoking form of heroin and cocaine. This you all know, IV combination of heroin and cocaine is called speedball. This has been asked multiple times in different exams. This is speedball. So let us start with number one. What is this combination of ecstasy with LSD? LSD is lysergic acid, diethylamide. What is this combination called? This is called candy flipping. Candy flipping. And a combination of ecstasy. Ecstasy is your MDMA, methamphetamine group of agents. Methylene, dioxin, methamphetamine. When it is mixed with sildenafil, that is your 5-PDE inhibitor, phosphodiesterase inhibitor. So if you mix these two agents, this is called sextasy. Ecstasy plus sildenafil. S for sildenafil, and ecstasy is your next alphabet. So this is called sextasy. Then the smoking form is called moon rocks. IV combination is called speedball. What is this E1? IV heroin in one arm and IV cocaine in another arm. What is this called? This is called stereo shooting. Then the combination of ethyl alcohol with chloral hydrate is an old question. It is also called Mickey Finn. This is called Mickey Finn or knockout drops. These combinations should be revised, and we have revised it. Correct? Let us move on to next one. Multiple correct answers can be there. Multiple correct. Like your INI CET has clearly mentioned that there will be single best answers and multiple correct answers. So this is a multiple correct answers question. So pick the correct answers. In an exhumed body, exhumed means digging out a dead body from the ground for re-postmortem to be done to confirm some new facts which might have arisen in the case. So which of the following poisons can be detected in that body which has been taken out from the burial site? At least tell one which is usually present. Which poison? So yes, multiple correct will be option C as well as option E. Endrin is a organochlorine group of compounds, and this can also be detected in exhumed dead bodies. And arsenic, you all know. Remember these two poisons which can be detected in exhumed dead body. Is there any time limit for exhumation to be done? Is there any time limit for exhumation to be done? Answer is, there is no time limit. And there is no time limit for one type of examination of witness in the courtroom. When the witness has come to record his evidence, we all also read that cross-examination part of the witness has no time limit. Cross-examination as well as exhumation, it has got no time limit legally. Exhumation can be done at any time. Cross-examination can continue for any period. So there is no time limit as such. Answer this one. Multiple correct options can be there. This is also a multiple correct question type. So more than one option can be correct. More than one option can be correct. So whenever a chronic alcoholic suddenly leaves alcohol, at about 2 to 3 days, the person goes into a state of delirium tremens. In delirium tremens, the person can present to you with excitatory features like agitation, tremors, along with the seizures or hallucinations. What is the cause of these features, these clinical features? The cause is in alcoholic withdrawal. There is increased N-methyl D-aspartate activity, means glutamate activity. Glutamate pathway becomes very active. And there is decreased activity of your inhibitory neurotransmitters like GABA. Okay. So B and D both will be correct. The opposite scenario, option A and option C, are associated with alcoholic intoxication. That is why alcohol is a CNS depressant, because in general it increases GABA activity and decreases NMDA activity. You can get questions like this. Then identify few things. Which is this plant? If I ask you, which is this poisonous plant or which is this fruit shown in the image? Everyone is able to identify this? Siddharth, in alcoholic poisoning, what happens is your NADH levels goes on increasing. So it is more of a biochemical disorder which happens in the body. So when your NADH increases and NAD is very low, so now your pyruvate get converts into lactic acid. So lactic acidosis occur. You read na, high anion gap metabolic acidosis. Then due to excess of lactic acid, your uric acid excretion is decreased. So in alcoholic, you see gouty arthritis due to increased uric acid levels. So it's more of a biochemical disorder which happens in the body. So this is your Dhatura plant, Dhatura poison, and this is Dhatura fruit. What is the shape of Dhatura fruit? Shape is round. What is the shape of Dhatura flowers? These are Dhatura flowers. And usually the number of petals, if you count, they will be 5. So the flowers are which shape? The flowers of Dhatura. Flowers are bell shape. Bell shape. And what is the shape of these Dhatura seeds present inside Dhatura fruit? Inside Dhatura fruit, the seeds will be there. So these seeds are kidney shape. What is the active principle in Dhatura poison? What is the active principle? Active principle is atropine, hyoscine, hyoscyamine. And this is a stupefying agent. What is the list of stupefying agents? Stupefying agents consists of your CCD coffee store, CCD, where C stands for cannabis. Another C stands for chloral hydrate. And D stands for Dhatura. Dhatura. Dhatura is also a stupefying substance. Correct? Recently asked in your INI November month. Now answer this one. Tall peak T wave in ECG is associated with which snake bite? What you will pick as the answer? These snakes are not given in the option. Usually sea snakes lead to rhabdomyolysis picture and they give rise to lots of rise of potassium in the body. Hyperkalemic picture giving rise to tall peak T waves. But now sea snake is not in the option. So what will be your next best answer? Always remember, for these questions, sea snake will be the best answer if present in the option. If not in the options, you can go with crabs. In some crab bites, hyperkalemia can be associated with crab bites. These are scorpion species, Mesobuthis, Chactidae. They are scorpion species. They are not snakes, actually. Then nose hummed viper. Viper are vasculotoxic. They will alter your different lab findings related to blood and coagulation system. Rat will be your best answer to pick. Answer this one. Multiple correct. Multiple correct answers can be there. A patient presents with hypocalcemic tetany features, which poisoning you will suspect? This is a question which should be marked 100% correctly. Which poisoning you will suspect? Everyone is confirmed with the answers now. So, a person presenting with hypocalcemic tetany features, the poisoning which can be suspected is oxalic acid, hydrofluoric acid, HF6 is hydrofluoric acid, and your ethylene glycol, because one of the metabolites of ethylene glycol is oxalic acid itself. The final metabolic product is oxalic acid itself. So this oxalic acid has a tendency to combine with calcium. Your HF6 combines with calcium and decreases the levels of calcium in the body, leading to hypocalcemic tetany features. Next one. Pick the single best answer. Single correct answer. A person working in battery making industry presents with anemic picture. This everyone will be confirmed, highly confirmed. So answer goes with yes. Lead leads to anemia picture, anemic picture. Normocytic normochromic anemia or sideroblastic anemia. Answer goes with lead. Suppose I make your question like, a person is working in silver jewelry making industry. And the question is only till here. A person is working in silver jewelry making industry. Which poisoning you will suspect? And the four options are these. What will be your next best answer? If instead of battery making industry, you are getting silver jewelry making industry. Can be asked as a question. Think. which of the following metallic poisons, metallic things, are utilized in silver jewelry making industry? Others also try. चांदी के गहने में किसका यूज होता? Mercury is used in hat making industry. Hat making industry. So the answer goes with cadmium. Cadmium is one thing which is used in silver jewelry industries, silver jewelry making industries. Remember this. Which leads to your Auchowicz disease, tie-dye disease, due to intense bone pains. Answer this one. Urine sample during autopsy is preserved in. Urine sample during autopsy is preserved in. Everyone is confirmed with this question. The correct answer goes with thymol. So rectified spirit is overall the best visceral preservative. This is how we remember it. Saturated saline solution or common salt solution is the most commonly used visceral preservative. Thymol is used for urine sample preservation during autopsy. Formalin is used as histopathology preservative. 10% formalin is used as preservative for histopathology of the organs. So during autopsy, we send the organ in a jar in which we add 10% formalin. We seal the jar. We hand it over to police official that please take this to pathology department, where histopathology of the organs will be done to find out the findings, histopath findings. These are your other important things which should be revised. Always revise this topic of visceral preservation and preservatives before any exam. One question sure shot from this topic, visceral preservation and preservatives. I have covered it in all the details in the classes. Answer this one. Swift disease is associated with which poison? Swift disease is associated with which poison? Everyone is confirmed, I think. Very good. Perfect. So answer goes with yes, mercury. Another name for acrodynia itself. Acrodynia, which is also called pink disease and sometimes called as swift disease, where painful pink puffy lesions, swollen lesions occur mainly in lower extremities, seen in mercury poisoning. Then what are the synonyms of chronic lead poisoning? It is also called Saturnism. Always remember this name. Or plumbism. Chronic arsenic poisoning, I can call this as arsenicosis. Arsenicosis. Then your cadmium poisoning is known by names like Auch disease. Or tie-dye disease. So go on answering few questions now. Which is the earliest feature of chronic arsenic poisoning? Earliest feature of chronic arsenic poisoning. What is the earliest feature of chronic arsenic poisoning? Quickly go on answering in the comment box, live chat window. Yes, emaciation to be remembered. What is the earliest feature of chronic lead poisoning? In lead poisoning, what is the earliest feature which the patient shows to you? Chronic lead poisoning, which is the earliest feature? Answer goes with सरकम ओरल पैलम, सरकम ओरल पैलम. This occurs due to anemic picture, which occurs in lead poisoning. What is the mechanism of lead poisoning? Mechanism of action is it inhibits your heme synthesis enzymes. Heme synthesis enzymes. So how does heme synthesis start? What is the initial substrate for heme synthesis? What is the initial substrate for heme synthesis? Which amino acid? Which amino acid combines with succinyl coenzyme A in the first step and your heme synthesis pathway starts? What is the name of that amino acid? Glycine. So glycine combines with succinyl coenzyme A in the presence of your ALA synthase enzyme, which is said to be the rate limiting enzyme, to form delta amino levulinic acid. Now there will be further breakdown of this, all these products. And what will be produced? The final output, that is heme. If the heme levels are very high, it will give a negative feedback to your ALA synthase that please stop working. If the heme synthesis is less, like in lead poisoning, which enzyme activity is going to increase? Answer is very simple. Yes, ALA synthase activity will increase. So there is a negative feedback mechanism of this heme, which acts as the regulator to regulate this rate limiting enzyme. Remember, this has been asked recently. In lead poisoning, which enzyme activity will be on the increase? ALA synthase. Then which enzymes are usually inhibited in lead poisoning? Let us quickly recap. ALA dehydratase. Then your coproporphyrenogen oxidase. Very long name. And another one is ferrochelatase. Ferrochelatase. These are the three enzymes which are inhibited. So as a result, delta ALA levels increase in the urine. When this is inhibited, increased levels of coproporphyrins occur in the urine. And this enzyme, ferrochelatase, is inhibited in red blood cells. So these are the two things which are raised in urine, and they help us in diagnosis of lead poisoning cases. So this was the episode 1 of your MCQs. Tomorrow we will have more MCQs in the form of episode 2 to revise certain other chapters which were not covered today, like your chapters of identification, thanatology, and many things from your legal procedures part. So tomorrow the sessions will be based on those 3 or 4 chapters: identification, legal procedures, and thanatology chapter. The timing is same for tomorrow, 11 to 11:30 a.m. in YouTube. So all the very best to all the aspirants who are going to give their exams. All the very best. Keep your spirits high, keep your confidence high. Clear? Okay then, bye bye. See you all in tomorrow's session at the same time.